Hey, it's DHA's Box of Rock. I am with, I can't even say my friends in Charm City Devils because I feel like you guys, we're like brother and sister.
We are.
I love you guys, John Allen, Ted Merrill, my buddies. It has been, I guess, close to 10 years that we've known each other. Has it been? Oh my gosh. Yeah. No, it really, really has.
I was just a little kid.
He was a twinkle in his daddy's eye.
He had his crew cut at that time, and it's been growing ever since. First of all, congratulations on a great new release. 1904. I want to talk to you guys about, because you know DHA is a station that's all about Jersey. We're very Jersey pride. You guys have always been very Baltimore pride. It is who you are. It is in the fiber of the band. Why is it so important that you are so connected to your community?
I have no idea. It's a quirky town, right? It's like a big small town, really.
Oh, I like that.
Baltimore.
Yeah. Yep.
Everybody knows everybody's business, you know. But I don't know. Growing up in a blue collar area where I grew up, it's ingrained, you know. The city's always been good to me in my career and embraced me, and so I embrace it.
You love it. I've heard you talk about, you know, look, I was down by the seaport last week and I was doing this and I was doing that. You're such a big part of that community. I want to talk to you a little bit about being the riff master, you know, on this new EP. So good. And, you know, you came up with so many great riffs for the Charm City sound, which is, you know, a little bit of everything. It's down and dirty rock and roll. It's got some blues in there. There's a little punky element. So talk to me a little bit about putting some of these songs together, including Skipping Stone, which is just such a great rocker.
Oh, man.
Thank you
very much.
Riffmaster Ted.
Riffmaster. Remember your manners, sir.
That's a great question. I don't know how I come up with any of this.
Yeah, really?
It just comes out, man.
It just comes out. Are you guys together, or does he call you and say, John, I got something, you got to get over here right now?
It depends on the situation. You know, we were talking about it on the way up here, and we were discussing, like, what we're thinking about, where the future lies and what, you know. But when it comes down to it, it's less about talk. It's about just getting in a room and kind of jamming on stuff. But it is.
Absolutely.
Like, he'll play a riff and I'll go, what is that? That's great. Like, and we'll record it, you know, and then I'll start, you know, like, yeah, scatting over top of it.
Scatting away. And you guys have such a good chemistry together, you know, such a great relationship.
Thank you.
So talk to me about 1904, because it does mean something. Mm-hmm. And again, we kind of circle back to Baltimore. So give me a little bit of backstory.
Yeah, there was a great fire in Baltimore in 1904, decimated the downtown area. Only a handful of buildings survived. And the city rose from the literal ashes at that point. And Baltimore's come under national spotlight, mm-hmm. unfortunately, mm-hmm. As of late, thanks to our president. Saying what a wonderful place it is. That's sarcasm, by the way.
Which probably hurt a little bit. Probably hurt you a little bit.
It did hurt. You know, it hurts when somebody, you know, says something about where you come from, and it hurts when it's somebody that powerful and that has that big of a platform. And So I was just feeling like if the city was able to rise once before, hopefully we can do that again. You know, and that's kind of what that was saying, and plus it kind of coincided with, it dovetailed with Charm City Devils coming back as well. Mm-hmm. So hopefully, you know,
yeah,
we all rise together, right?
Yeah. Because you guys have also had a side project called Stone Horses,
right.
And you guys have done so much for me personally. I want to thank you, actually, in helping with Rock and Rough and our animal causes. These guys are the first guys. You guys are doing something. Where do we need to be and when? You know, we'll just put everything down and we'll come out. We'll help you with the shelters. We'll help you with the animals. So you guys have been such great friends.
Anything,
you know,
for the dogs.
To us. I and you guys are so down with it. As soon as you see the dogs, the guys are like, yeah. And you, my friend, we talked about it once before when I had you on the show. You've walked in the Barks Fashion Show. You've always been a huge animal supporter. You have your great little Show Us Your Soft Side. I love John's campaign. He's always like, Terry, you keep sharing it. But, you know, it's great because it's, you know, artists that support animal rescue and being anti-cruel to animals, which is something we can't conceive of at all. You know, so why has that been important to you guys to always be able to give back and help out?
You know, I've had pets my entire life, you know, so it's something that's close to my heart, you know, like we had dogs growing up always, and then later on, you know, I've had girlfriends who had cats, and so now, you know, I'm a cat dad and everything. But one of my earliest memories was catching. I had a toad at one point when I was a kid, and I kept that toad, and one day that toad died, you know, and I had a wake. I had a funeral for him for like 3 days, man. I've always loved animals, you know. That poor guy, man. Yeah. I feel bad for him. I should have let him go, right? But you know.
What are you going
to
do?
And it's so amazing because, you know, when we do anything and we have our artists that just are so giving. And, I can't thank you guys enough for that.
The toad story got me.
Yeah, I was just like, oh, my God, with the poor toad.
I didn't kill him. We had an unseasonably warm spring day. He decided to come out from hibernation. And when I left that day, he was sitting in the water dish. When I got home, it had been cold. I guess it had cooled off, and I guess he froze to death.
Oh,
I don't know. He was still sitting in the water dish. It wasn't my fault, is what I'm saying. All right.
John was trying. He was really trying. So what's going on? What does the future hold for Charm City Devils? It's so nice to see you guys make such an amazing comeback. And by the way, doing a lot of it kind of on your artists these days now are sort of becoming more independent.
Right.
And you're able to say, you know what, we want to do this. I just talked to Dorothy Martin. Yeah. She's a great new artist. And she's like, you know what, I just want to release music. I'm just going to start releasing music. Yeah. I don't care. I don't want people telling me which music to release and what, you know. I want to release music. So what does the future hold for you guys in this sort of newfound independence for the band?
Well, first of all, I'm a huge fan of Dorothy's. Secondly, that's true. There's nothing more frustrating than, like, when we were signed to labels and you had to operate on their schedule. You know, like, the first deal that Charm City Devils had, our record sat on a shelf for a year before it came out. And, it, you know, in a lot of ways it hurt us because our hometown was already playing the hell out of our first single. And by the time the single finally came out nationally, they couldn't play it anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, it was done there. So there are all these, like, this is backstory, you know, industry stuff that a lot of people don't know about that occurs, you know. But you're always, like, on a schedule, and it depends on their time frame. So, like Dorothy was saying, our plan is we're working on two brand new songs right now that I'm hoping to get out. I'm gonna put on Spotify, you know, just throw them out there. Like she said, like, just gonna release music, you know, just put it out there for people as quickly as we can get it done and get it out there and then tour dates for the summer.
Awesome.
Sounds like a plan.
Always happy to see you guys. Thank you guys so much. Charm City Devils, John and Ted.